Unfortunately, what we heard today from Prime Minister Imran Khan of Pakistan was a callous portrayal of the world in binary terms. Us versus them, rich versus poor, north versus south, developed versus developing, Muslims versus others. Prime Minister Imran Khan's threat of unleashing nuclear devastation qualifies as brinksmanship, not statesmanship. Even coming from the leader of a country that has monopolized the entire value chain of the industry of terrorism, Prime Minister Khan's justification of terrorism was brazen and incendiary. For someone who was once a cricketer and believed in the gentleman's game, today's speech bordered on crudeness of a variety reminiscent of the guns of Dara Adam Khel. Mr. President, now that Prime Minister Imran Khan has invited UN observers to Pakistan to verify that there are no militant organizations in Pakistan, the world will hold him to that promise. Mr. President, Pakistan's virulent reaction to the removal of an outdated and temporary provision that was hindering development and integration of the Indian state of Jammu and Kashmir stems from the fact that those who thrive on conflict never welcome the ray of peace. While Pakistan has ventured to upstream terrorism and downstream hate speech there, India is going ahead with mainstreaming development in Jammu and Kashmir. The mainstreaming of Jammu and Kashmir, as well as Ladakh, in India's thriving and vibrant democracy with a millennia-old heritage of diversity, pluralism, and tolerance is well and truly underway. Irreversibly so. The citizens of India do not need anyone else to speak on their behalf, least of all those who have built an industry of terrorism from the ideology of hate. Here are a few questions that Pakistan can respond to as a precursor to the proposed verification. Can Pakistan confirm the fact that it is home to 130 UN-designated terrorists and 25 terrorist entities listed by the UN as of today? Will Pakistan acknowledge that it is the only government in the world that provides pension to an individual listed by the UN in the Al-Qaeda and Daesh sanctions list? Can Pakistan explain why, here in New York, its premier bank, the Habib Bank, had to shut shop after it was fined millions of dollars over terror financing? Will Pakistan deny that the Financial Action Task Force has put the country on notice for its violations of more than 20 of the 27 key parameters? And finally, would Prime Minister Khan deny to the city of New York that he was an open defender of Osama bin Laden? Mr. President, having mainstreamed terrorism and hate speech, Pakistan is trying to play its wild card as the newfound champion of human rights. This is a country that has shrunk the size of its minority community from 23% in 1947 to 3% today, and has subjected Christians, Sikhs, Ahmadiyyas, Hindus, Shias, Pashtuns, Sindhis, and Balochis to draconian blasphemy laws, systemic persecution, and blatant abuse and forced conversions. Their newfound fascination for preaching human rights is akin to trophy hunting of the endangered mountain goat, the Markhor. Pogroms, Prime Minister Imran Khan Niazi, are not a phenomenon of today's vibrant democracies. We would request you to refresh your rather sketchy understanding of history. Do not forget the gruesome genocide perpetrated by Pakistan against its own people in 1971, and the role played by Lieutenant General A.A.K. Niazi.
आप ह्यूमन राइट की बात कर रहे हो, सूफी संतों की बड़ी परंपरा कश्मीर के अंदर थी, पूरे के पूरा सूफी संप्रदाय उखाड़ कर फेंक दिया। उस वक्त कहां थे ह्यूमन राइट के चैंपियन? लाखों हजारों कश्मीरी पंडित दर दर आज भी अपने देश के अंदर निर्वासित होकर भटक रहे हैं, उनके ह्यूमन राइट की चिंता नहीं है आपको? कौन जिम्मेदार है इस स्थिति? किसको जवाब देना है इस स्थिति का? और ये सवाल कभी उस देश में उठाए नहीं गए, जो उठाते थे उनको दरकिनार किया गया। मगर मैं आज कहना चाहता हूं कि धारा 370 हटने के बाद थोड़े ही समय में कश्मीर पूर्ववत स्थिति में आएगा और हम आराम से देख सकेंगे कि कश्मीर ये देश की तरह हमारा है।
यूएन पीस कीपिंग मिशंस में सबसे बड़ा बलिदान अगर किसी देश ने दिया है तो वो देश भारत है। हम उस देश के वासी हैं जिसने दुनिया को युद्ध नहीं बुद्ध दिए हैं, शांति का संदेश दिया है। और इसलिए हमारी आवाज में आतंक के खिलाफ दुनिया को सतर्क करने की गंभीरता भी है और आक्रोश भी। हम मानते हैं कि ये किसी एक देश की नहीं बल्कि पूरी दुनिया की और मानवता की सबसे बड़ी चुनौतियों में से एक है। आतंक के नाम पर बटी हुई दुनिया उन सिद्धांतों को ठेस पहुंचाती है जिनके आधार पर यूएन का जन्म हुआ है। और इसलिए मानवता की खातिर, आतंक के खिलाफ पूरे विश्व का एकमत होना, एकजुट होना मैं अनिवार्य समझता हूं।
मैं मानता हूं कि आने वाले दिनों के अंदर कश्मीर का जो विकास रुका पड़ा था, कश्मीरी लोगों को जो अधिकार नहीं मिलता था, आज तक पंचायत के चुनाव नहीं कराए, हमने पंचायत के चुनाव करा दिए। 40,000 पंच सरपंच आज गांव के अंदर गांव के विकास का खाका खुद खींच रहे हैं। चार पांच दिन के बाद तहसील पंचायत और जिला पंचायत के चुनाव होंगे। थ्री टायर पंचायत सिस्टम पूरी की पूरी कश्मीर के अंदर अप्लाई हो जाएगी और भारत सरकार 7,000 करोड़ रुपया वो गांव के विकास के लिए भेजेगी, जिसको सीधा वो सरपंच खर्च करने वाले। जो पैसा सचिवालय से नीचे नहीं जाता था वो डायरेक्ट बेनिफिट ट्रांसफर के माध्यम से हर घर में पहुंचेगा। हर विधवा को 600 रुपया मिलेगा, हर बूढ़े व्यक्ति को 500 रुपये का पेंशन मिलेगा और सीधा उसके अकाउंट के अंदर मिलेगा। सारा के सारा रोक कर रखा था, शौचालय नहीं बना दिए, बिजली नहीं पहुंचने दी, पानी नहीं पहुंचने दिया। और ये सारा विकास अब होना शुरू होगा क्योंकि नरेंद्र मोदी जी ने एक रास्ता साफ कर दिया विकास के लिए। भारत की संसद ने जितने भी कानून बनाए थे वो सारे के सारे कानून आज कश्मीर की जनता के लिए उपलब्ध है। वो उनका अधिकार है और वो अपने अधिकार का प्रयोग कर सकते हैं।
In the last 30 years, 42,000 people got killed. The fact that the level of intimidation had reached a height where you had senior police officers lynched on the streets of Srinagar. You had journalists who wrote against separatism who were assassinated. You had military personnel returning home for Eid who were kidnapped and killed. So, you know, pre-August 5, please remember this. Pre-August 5, Kashmir was in a mess. I mean, the difficulties in Kashmir have not started on August 5. August 5 is supposed to be a way of dealing with those difficulties. So the choices were either you continue what was clearly not working, or you tried something very different. And I think the decision was to try something very different. So our expectation today is by doing away with what was a temporary provision, what was meant as a bridge but became a barrier, that we will be able to push investments, economic activities into Kashmir, that we will be able to, frankly, change the economic landscape, change the social landscape.